Hello there, monsters and men, ladies and people, and welcome to Recharging. Today is the only cloudy day of the week, but that doesn't matter because today is still my lucky day because I had the opportunity to test drive this Audi e-tron. The Audi e-tron 55, actually, so it's the most powerful version out there. Now, the e-tron is actually the first electric Audi that they made, but it actually looks like every other Audi. It even has the Audi grille that you can see over here. Most of it is fake or closed, however you want to call it, because, well, it is an electric car, so it doesn't need as much cooling as a regular internal combustion engine car. But you can still recognize that it is an Audi. Besides that, it actually looks, well, quite normal. The only way that you can see that this is an electric Audi is because of the e-tron badge here on the side. So what if we look at the back? We will skip the front for now, but if we have a look at the back seats. So we're now at the back seats. The seat in front of me is in my typical driving position. I am 1 meter and 85 centimeters. And as you can see, I have loads of knee room over here and loads of headroom. We also have this very nice panoramic roof over here. And if you close the door for a minute, you will actually notice that the quality in here is pretty good. Well, it is an Audi, but everything is nice to touch. Everything feels rock solid. It feels like it will last, but what do you expect for this price? And, well, again, it is an Audi. So what do we have more over here? The car is very wide, so you can actually sit here with three persons quite easy. There's no hump in the floor because, well, it is an electric car, so we don't need that. There is separate climate control for you over here, so that is luxurious. There's actually an armrest over here with two cup holders and a little cubby, in my opinion, useless cubby over here. But it is there, so that is nice. Oh, it's not closing. Yep. Besides that, it is pretty, well, it's pretty good here in the back seat. You will last here for a long time. So let's have a look at the back of the car. This car actually has the signature Audi tail light. So that means you have this LED bar over here that will light up in the dark. So you have one big tail light. And if we have a look at the boot, there's a little tractor coming. It's always the wrong timing. And because of some editing magic, the tractor is now gone. But if we have a look at the boot, you'll actually see a boot space of 660 liters. So that is quite a lot. You can see this is quite high, so you have to lift your stuff pretty high to get it in the boot. But if you have it in the boot, there's actually a flat floor, so that is good. There's also a little space over here where you can charge your charge cables, your safety vest, etc. And if we put down the rear seats, you can actually do that by these levers over here, so that is quite handy, and they will just fall flat like that. So we pull these two levers, you will actually see a boot space of 1700 liters, so that is a lot. And again, the question is, can you fit a human over here? Well, the same as with the Jaguar I-Pace. You can camp here with two humans very easily. So this is also good, but as I said, I only have this car for today. So let's not waste any more time. Let's drive with the car. So I have driven this car now for a few hours, but before we go to talk about that, let's first talk about the front interior, because it is an Audi and it is an expensive car, so you expect quality, and quality is what you get. The materials that are being used are very good, so there's soft touch over here, nicely brushed aluminum over here, nice leather over here, also on the doors, a little bit of Alcantara. Most of it feels nice and are nice materials, but even for an Audi at this price point, there are some scratchy materials, like here on the center console. Ooh, no, that does not pass the test at all. Not at all. What this Audi does have done, though, is these screens over here, the mirrors. We will get to that later, but they are very fancy. And besides those screens, this Audi has actually three more screens, because it has one for your climate control down here. It has one for your multimedia, which you can find here in the upper center console. And there's one for the driver, the Audi virtual cockpit. And, well, the Jaguar I-Pace also had three screens, but these screens are nicer than in the Jaguar I-Pace. And why is that? Well, they are more intuitive. They are more responsive, and well, as a tech guy over me, they are just more frames per second. So in the Jaguar, I have noticed that the screens were probably not 60 frames per second, so it didn't feel as fluently as these screens are, because well, these are 60 frames per second easily. So that's where the tech guys up here. Besides that though, all the screens, well, these two screens are touchscreen. That has a downside because they are touchscreen and you do everything with this screen. So when you want to control your temperature or your heated seats or something in the multimedia, you do actually have to take your eyes off the road to use them. So that is a downside. What is cool though is, though that they are touchscreens, you actually have to press the screen pretty hard, and then you get a little bit of feedback. So it actually feels like you are touching a real button. You're not, but it feels like it. I think that's pretty cool. But again, they are touchscreens, so you still have to take your eyes off the road because there are no physical buttons if you want to do something. What did I find in these two screens though is, well, there is, for example, a feature up here where you can actually open your garage door when you're in your car. I don't know how that will work, but it is awesome anyway that you can do it. I think a Tesla can also do that. Besides that, for example, if we have the parking sensors on, there's also a 3D view of the car, so you can actually look around the car in 3D, which is pretty handy for parking. I've already used it for it. I love this feature. Besides that, again, the screen is responsive. You have your media for your radio. There's actually an opportunity to link your phone through Apple CarPlay or Android Auto. Again, it worked good, but it is nice that this feature is here if you want to use your phone's navigation. You can also use the onboard navigation because, well, it works pretty well. It is responsive and this car is also online. It's probably due a subscription. So after, I don't know, maybe 2-3 years, the online feature will be gone, but it works pretty well. It is fast and the live traffic is also pretty good, actually. Better than most navigations I have used. Then, of course, you have your car info where you can set your charging limit, your regen for your seats. You can do your climate, you can do your drive mode selection, all that good stuff. And then there is also a profile feature. So you can save different profiles in this car. That is cool because those profiles will remember your settings. So if you have, you share this car with your family, each family member has a different profile. They do everything of their liking. They save it in a profile, and when they get in the car, they just activate the profile and everything is how they want it to be. So that is all very good. That's all very good. So how is the Audi e-tron like to drive? Well, let's first start with the raw numbers. The Audi e-tron that I'm currently driving, the Audi e-tron 55, has 408 horsepower. And with that 408 horsepower, it can do 0 to 100 kilometers an hour in 5.7 seconds. So it is not as fast as a Jaguar I-Pace or a Tesla. It's not as explosive. It's still fast though. I mean, 5.7 seconds is fast, but it is not as explosive as a Tesla or a Jaguar. The top speed of this car is actually limited to 200 kilometers an hour. That's plenty, of course. And the Audi e-tron 55 actually has a 95 kilowatt hour battery pack. 95, I mean, that is big. And with that battery pack, it can drive around. Well, when I got the car this morning, it was charged to 100%. And the gasometer actually guessed that I could do around 300 kilometers on a full state of charge, which is not a lot actually. I think when you drive normally, because I have been driving today, just mixed traffic, I think in winter you will do 300 to 350 kilometers on one state of charge. And I think if you drive normally, in summer, you can do 350 to 400 kilometers on one state of charge. But still, that is not that much for a 95 kilowatt hour battery pack. So what is one of the reasons that this car does 350 to 400 kilometers on one state of charge? Well, that is because this car is heavy. And because it's heavy, it's... Well, I think because it's heavy, it's also thirsty. And what is heavy then? Well, this car weighs 2,500 kilos. Almost 2,500 kilos. Can you imagine that? I mean, that is a lot. That's partly due because of the large battery pack. But still, 2,500 kilos is a lot. And with that, it's also thirsty. I mean, I've been driving again in mixed traffic today, and I've done 28 kilowatt hour per 100 kilometers. So if we calculate that again, 350 kilometers. You don't really notice that weight. I mean, again, it is heavy, but Audi actually fitted this car with standard air suspension. They probably did that to so that you won't notice the heavy weight of this car. Which is good though, because the air suspension is really comfortable. I mean, I thought the Jaguar I-Pace was comfortable. This car is more comfortable. It's more comfortable and it's more quiet than the Jaguar I-Pace. So how does this car handle then? Well, again, it doesn't handle as good as, for example, a Jaguar. But it doesn't have to, because, well, it isn't a Jaguar because it has four rings and not a Jaguar. But it handles, well, to be honest, I don't know, because I haven't driven a lot of Audis. I think this is my first one. But I have driven some Volkswagens and it handles exactly like them. I mean, it's very neutral. Nobody will probably love it, but nobody will hate it either. They're very easy to drive, and this one is the same. You can actually select different driving modes for this car, so comfort, dynamic, even off-road. Well, I don't think you should take this car off-road, but it has one. It can probably do it a little, but I would not recommend it. Those drive modes actually do adjust the air suspension a little bit, so it makes it more stiff or more comfortable. Of course the throttle response, and if you put it on sport, the steering is a little bit heavier than normal. But I will just leave it in comfort, because that is what this car is made for, in my opinion. Just leave it in comfort. It is an excellent cruiser. It's very quiet. I mean, I thought that it's my reference for a premium car. I thought the Jaguar was quiet. This is even one step higher. I mean, it's, you can cruise with this car for longer distances easily. And then you might think, yeah, well, I can cruise for longer distances, but the range is only 350 kilometers, so I cannot go far, and it has a large battery pack. But the good thing is, this car charges very fast, but we come to that later. The other gimmick though about this car, yeah, is it a gimmick or is it actually helpful, are the digital mirrors. You might have already seen it. So the mirrors are actually cameras instead of mirrors, and you have a screen here in your door where you can see the output of the camera. The benefit of this is that the car actually has 10 kilometers more range. I know, it's not a lot. It's not a lot. I personally find it a gimmick. I mean, I think the mirrors work well. Maybe it's something we have to get used to, but I don't see really the benefit of it. And that's also because there could be some glare in the screens up here where the mirrors are displayed. And it's also harder to see your depth in this screen. Again, you will get used to it, but for the money, I think they're quite expensive. I would not bother, and I would actually, especially not bother for those 10 kilometers. It really doesn't matter. But they look cool, I gotta give him that. So what about all the safety features and driving assistance features of this car? Well, this car has everything that you wish for, everything that you can expect from a car from this price point and this class. I mean, you have lane keeping assist, you have pedestrian detection, front collision warning. It will actually, of course, brake when it detects that you are going to hit something. It has adaptive cruise control. The adaptive cruise control keeps you in lane. It will steer with you in curves. Again, it has everything that you can wish for from a car of this class and this price point. It's cool that it has the driving features, but what about the electric driving features? What about one pedal driving and all that good stuff? Well, the Audi doesn't do that well, actually. It actually drives pretty much like a regular combustion engine automatic car. For example, the regen, there's no one pedal driving, it just isn't there. Oh crap, I just took a very narrow road, and the lane keeping assist will probably bother me with that. So let's just drive a little bit slower, so it won't. But again, it doesn't have one pedal driving. It has regen, it has an automatic function, and it has a manual function. The automatic function will determine automatically what it has to do, so it can be the most efficient. But again, the automatic function, in my opinion, lets you roll too much. It will just decouple the engines and let you roll freely too much. Because what I want of an electric car is when I lift off my foot of the accelerator, I want it to regen. And it doesn't. It doesn't do that by default as much. So I put it on manual. But even then, if you put it on manual, you can set the regen rate with these two flippers here on the steering wheel. But you will never be able to do one pedal driving. So even when you put it on the strongest setting, it will only go to half of the charge meter. Oh, I'm going too quick. It's beeping at me. Again, it's a very narrow road. It will only go to half of the regen meter of your power gauge. So that is not that much. That's not that much in my opinion. So I would like that to be better. Also, the indication on what charging level you are currently on is very narrow. It's a very tiny white little stripe in your regen gauge. So that can be improved in my opinion. It will actually do full regen though if you put your foot on the brake pedal. Then the meter can go all the way. It will charge it will regen all the way. But you have to put your foot on the brake, and then it is just a regular combustion engine automatic car. So this car is very normal. It's actually a very accessible car for people who don't want to know that they're driving an electric car. It sounds maybe a little bit weird, but it feels a little bit like that. What is also a little bit flimsy though about this car is the famous Volkswagen stick of cruise control, that little stick that pops up under your steering wheel. I just think it's flimsy. I just like buttons on my steering wheel. I mean, look at this gap in my steering wheel. I can put my fist through it. As you can see, we're in a corner, so maybe it was not that safe. But anyway, as I can show you now, I can put my fist through it, but why not put your buttons here, man? You have enough space. Just do it. The car is currently being charged to 100%, and that is because, sadly, we almost have to return the Audi e-tron. The Audi e-tron is charging at a 350 kilowatt charger, and that is because the Audi e-tron can actually take 150 kilowatts of power from a charger. 150 kilowatts, that is a lot. And it can also do that from 0 to 80%. It will keep that 150 kilowatts when you're charging DC. I mean, that is insane. Even a Tesla, I think, doesn't do that. I don't know how they do it, because a lot of other cars actually ramp down a lot sooner than this Audi e-tron does. But again, from 0 to 80%, it will take 150 kilowatts, and after that, it will slowly ramp down. I heard, but I don't know if this is true, that the Audi e-tron actually has a large enough buffer to cope with the degradation you get from charging this fast, this long of a time, to that state of charge. Again, I don't know if that is true, but that is what I heard. So it can take up to 150 kilowatts on DC, and on AC it can actually take 11 kilowatts. And that is great. So it means it can take three-phase charging. So that also means if you go somewhere, you stay there for a day, you're on a three-phase charger, you can actually leave with a full battery again to return home. You don't have to stop for fast charging. And even then, with 150 kilowatts, and this car, from 0 to 80%, it will do that in 20 minutes. So it's ridiculously fast. And because of that fast charging, this car is actually suited for longer distances. It is, because, well, you drive 200-300 kilometers. I mean, you drive on the highway somewhere in Germany, pretty quick, it is thirsty. So 250 to 300 kilometers. You need a break, you need to go to the toilet, you need a coffee. Well, at least I do after 2 hours. So you do that, and when you come back, this car is actually charged to 80% again. It's insane how quick it is. I love it. What is also genius about this Audi e-tron, and I don't know why other car manufacturers think about this, because I'm not a big fan of the charge port here on the side. But what Audi has done, they actually put one on the left side And on the right side, it's genius. I mean, on the right side, you only have a Type 2 connection. So if we open up this one, which we cannot do because the car is locked. Anyway, on the right side, there's only a Type 2 connection. And on the left side, there is a Type 2 connection with the DC CCS connection, which is great. So that means if you park somewhere on the streets, it doesn't matter how you park the car, you always manage to reach your charge port either on the left or either on the right. And I think, again, it's brilliant. So with saying that, what is my first impression of the Audi e-tron? Well, it is quiet, it's comfortable, it feels well built. Yeah, it is thirsty, and yeah, it is heavy. But it makes up with that with the insanely quick charging speed. Again, I don't know what the charging speed will do to the battery in the long run. Nobody knows. Probably Audi thought of this and it will be okay, but we don't know. But it is proven by other YouTubers that this car can do 1000 kilometers in an insanely quick speed, almost as fast as a internal combustion engine car. And therefore I think that this car is one of the best premium electric SUVs that you can currently buy. So if you like this video, please give a like and subscribe. If you did not, please leave a comment below to see what I can improve. And then I would like to say, as always, thank you a lot for watching and to be continued.